بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين، ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. I want first to welcome Sister Yuri. It's an honor to have her here. And I was just looking, I was shown a collection of some of the letters that she received from Malcolm X or Malcolm Shabazz, rahimahullah. We called him Shahid America. And I was struck by this letter that he wrote her. It was from Kuwait on the 27th of September, 1964. And it says, "Still trying to travel and broaden my scope, since I've learned what a mess can be made by narrow-minded people." And it's signed Brother Malcolm X. And I think that if we look at the current situation that we find ourselves in, it's certainly quite a mess. And I would confer with the Imam that it's largely been made by narrow-minded people. Ezra Pound said that provincialism is the enemy. And provincialism is seeing things only from your own perspective. And so the idea of traveling in order to broaden one's scope, because one of the interesting things about the world, they used to say, seeing is believing. But the postmodernists inverted that and they said, believing is seeing. And what they meant by that is that it is your belief system which will determine what you see in the world. And one of the troubles that I've always had is in separating between my subjective experience and my objective knowledge. My subjective experience of the world has been largely good. And I can honestly say that the vast majority of human beings that I have met and spent any time with, I have actually enjoyed being with them. It's the anomalous experience I've found of being with people that I did not enjoy being with, and I can't say like Will Rogers, I think his name was, who said, "I never met a man I didn't like." I wish I could say that. That's called a maqam in the Islamic tradition, which is a station with God, and it's the station of al-Waduliyah. According to Ibn Ajiba, he says in his commentary on the 99 names, that the one who realizes the name Al-Wadud, which means the loving God, the one who yatahaqqaqu haqiqat al-sifa, he realizes the reality of that attribute of God, he can have no hate in his heart for anyone. And we notice in the Quran when the Prophet mentions the people that he says, "I hate your actions." The Prophet says, "I hate your actions," when he spoke to his people. And the commentators say, a prophet could not call a people to the truth if he hated them. He would actually have to have some concern for them in order to call them to the truth. And therefore, what the prophets hate is not the person or the human being, but they hate the actions that emanate from them that harm themselves and harm others. And this is why the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ in Sahih al-Bukhari once, according to the hadith, which is an absolutely sound hadith, saw a funeral passing, and he stood up, and the Sahaba, one of the companions, said, "Ya Rasulullah, O Messenger of God, this is a Jew." And he said, "Awalaysat nafsa," isn't it a soul? And this gets to something very deep that Dr. Omar was talking about earlier, and also Imam Siraj, when he described himself as four things. When I was studying Arabic logic, one of my teachers explained to me the difference between an arab and the that, something that is essential and something that's particular. And the example that he used was a circle or a ball, a kura. And he said, if you have a kura hamra, a red ball, is the redness necessary in order for the ball to be a ball? And I said, no. And he said that that's an arab. And then he said, is the circular nature of the ball necessary in order for it to be a ball? And I said, yes. And he said, that is essential. And that is the difference in logic between something which is essential and something which is particular or non-essential. And when we talk about ourselves, when Imam Siraj spoke about being a Muslim, and then the next three things that were mentioned, a black man, an African, and an American, out of all of those things, there was only one that was essential. And the others were incidental. What was essential was his state and relationship with his Creator. And I know that the Imam would not claim to be a Muslim in the sense that he claims to be in a state of absolute submission with his Lord. But what he says when he says, I am a Muslim, I am committed to the path of surrender to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that is why it's essential, because that, according to the Muslims, is what goes on in the next world. As for the color, as for the country, the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, said, everyone is issued a passport in order to get into paradise. It's in a hadith that Salman al-Farisi relates, and he used the word jawaz, which is the modern Arabic word for passport, which did not exist at the time that he was speaking. He said, everybody is given a passport, and on that passport it says, Udkhulu bi salamin aminin. Enter into this place with peace, in a state of tranquility and security. And it's said in one tradition that when the believers first come into paradise, they repeat for what is an untold number or an untold amount of time the word salam. They just keep repeating over and over again, salam, 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 which is peace, peace, peace. Because finally, what they were always looking for has been achieved. And this is where we get into the topic here of between war and understanding. War is a very interesting phenomenon. It's existed as long as human beings. According to the Quran, according to the Bible, we have at the outset of this human experience a conflict between the children of Adam. And I would say that I would add a fifth quality to Imam Siraj, and that is that he is Adami, that he is a human being. He is a child of Adam, and that is essential and not incidental. And while our skin tones might differ, our Adamic nature does not differ. And that is what really bonds us at a much deeper reality. And that's why we have come from different worlds in this country. We have different life experiences, and yet we have come together as brothers that share something very powerful. And the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, said, أَلَا لَا إِمَانَ لِمَنْ لَا مَحَبَّةَ لَهُ. He has no faith, the one who has no love. أَلَا لَا إِمَانَ لِمَنْ لَا مَحَبَّةَ لَهُ. He has no faith, the one who has no love, and he repeated it three times. And he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, أَلَا أَدُلُّكُمْ عَلَى شَيْءٍ إِنْ فَعَلْتُمُوهُ تَحَابَتْتُمْ فِي اللَّهِ. Can't I point you people to something that if you did it, you would have love for one another? And he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, أَفْشُ السَّلَامْ بَيْنَكُمْ. Spread peace amongst yourselves. And I was with Sheikh Abdullah al-Qadi in Medina once. We were in a masjid, in the mosque of the Prophet, peace be upon him, and they have people at the doors that sometimes are very gruff. And there was a man there at the door where we used to go through at Fajr, which is the dawn prayer, and we would walk in, and I would say, Salaam alaikum, to him. And he would say, Wa alaikum salam. And so the next day, I said to Sheikh Abdullah al-Qadi, I want to experiment with that hadith that the Prophet said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, can I indicate something to you? If you did it, you would start loving each other and spread peace. And so the next day, I saw the same man. I said, Salaam alaikum. He said, Wa alaikum salam. A little less drunk, but we weren't there yet. On the third day, I saw the same man. And I was with Sheikh Abdullah al-Qadi, who's my witness. And he's a deaf one. And I said, Salaam alaikum. And he said, Wa alaikum salam. And he smiled. And then on the fourth day, we came in, and Allah is my witness. I said, Salaam alaikum. And he came up and he hugged me. He gave me a hug. And he was saying, Marhaban. And what that indicated to me is human beings can be worn down. Just as you have wars of attrition, you also have peace of attrition. In other words, you need to wear your opponent down. And sometimes people are belligerent for very valid reasons that the Imam was mentioning earlier. But that belligerence can still be removed with good intentions and goodwill, but it takes effort. One of the interesting things about English is that war is actually a positive metaphor. We talk about the war on drugs or the war on terrorism. In the Arabic language, war is a negative metaphor. The Arabs would never talk about a war against something evil. They would talk about a jihad. Because jihad is very different from war, and it needs to be seen as that. According to the Imams of Islam, Ibn Rushd said that the meaning of jihad, there are two meanings of jihad. There is the principle of jihad, which is called the mabda, and then there's the institution of jihad. The principle of jihad is a universal principle that has nothing to do with military endeavors, nothing whatsoever. That is the principle of jihad. It is to struggle and oppose what is wrong in yourself and what is around you. But then there's the institution of jihad, which is a state institution. And according to the scholars, it is instituted by a legal government for the removal of belligerence. And that is the wording in the Arabic language. Al-jihadu mudafa'atu al-aduwi li'izalati al-kirama. Jihad is opposing enemies in order to remove belligerence. And it is not a war, because one of the things that war does is it destroys human beings. And if you don't believe me, I would recommend reading a book called War is a Force That Gives Us Meaning by Chris Hedges, who was a war correspondent for 20 years. He was in Bosnia, he was in South America, he was in Central America, he was in Palestine, he saw Khan Yunus camps, he saw 10-year-old children seduced out into the open by Lebanese Christian mercenaries working for Israeli troops in the Arabic language, and then shot with M16s with silencers on them. This is a New York Times correspondent, a winner of many awards in journalism, who saw that. He said it's the only time in his 20 years of war coverage where he saw children purposely seduced out in order to eliminate. He said in Sarajevo, the snipers targeted children. But he said here, he saw with his own eyes children being seduced out because their mothers were being cursed in Arabic. And they came out to throw rocks. In that book, what he says, he talks about the addiction of war, the power of war, the seductive nature of war, that people become seduced by war. Charles Lindbergh Jr., who flew across the Atlantic, gave a speech in 1941, just before the attack on Pearl Harbor, and in that speech he said, why are our cinemas and theaters being filled with plays and films that glorify war? This is propaganda. Because when you watch Mel Gibson, who never seems to die, no matter how many bullets are flying around, glorifying the war in Vietnam, which is a shameful blemish on the history of this country, glorifying the war, the incineration of people that were being killed, and this is a little known fact, being killed because of a very rare metal known as tungsten, which is actually in Eisenhower's speech, warning this country about the military-industrial complex, but also talking about the necessity of not allowing Vietnam to fall to the Chinese, because there are only two major sources of tungsten in the world, China and Vietnam. And tungsten is a very important metal for high-tech instruments. War is something that people get addicted to, and now we see all of these. When I went into Barnes & Noble just after September 11th, there was all these amazing displays of World War II, and right before that we had a movie about Pearl Harbor, which was a love story. Isn't that interesting? So you associate one of the most heinous attacks on this country with a love story, where the emotions are aroused. So this book is a testimony to the terror of war. And it was an American Confederate general, Robert E. Lee, who said war is hell. And he became the rector of a military institute in the South after the war, and they said that during the drills he used to purposely march out of step. Because people that have seen what those people have seen either become addicted and want more, or they become horrified and want to put an end to it. And those are the choices. Now, if you look at the two great classics in the Western civilization that are foundational to what's called the Greco-Roman civilization, the Iliad and the Odyssey by the blind poet Homer, the Iliad is about war, but the Odyssey is about the attempt to get home after you've been through a war. And what happens to Ulysses or Odysseus in his attempt to go back to normality after he's been through a bloody and carnage-filled experience. Very difficult. And when he gets home, the first thing he does is massacre all the guests in his house. So it's interesting when our special forces fellows get back from Afghanistan and go to Fort Bragg and kill four women who happen to be their wives. It's very difficult to come back home after you've been in a war. Because war has a very, very terrible effect on the soul. It's not easy to kill a person. Clint Eastwood makes it very easy when he says, make my day. You don't see Clint Eastwood in those films suffering the addiction of alcohol or drugs to attempt to remove the memory of that person making his day. They don't tell you that more Vietnam veterans have committed suicide than died in Vietnam, or that over 20% of the homeless in this country are Vietnam veterans. Because those are the Ulysses that nobody cares about, trying to make their way back home after the carnage. So when we hear the drums of war being drummed up, it's time to seriously wake up and consider who's manipulating who. It's very easy to manipulate people. Sun Tzu said, anger opponents so as to throw them into disarray. And that was a book called The Art of War. Anger opponents so as to throw them in disarray. But the same philosopher of war also said, a wise general or leader will never start a war in a state of anger. Because a nation once destroyed can never be brought back, and a life once taken can never be restored. So those Afghanis that were celebrating their wedding feast, when the cluster bomb fell on them, who can bring them back? And where's the memorial for them? And where are the tears for those people? One of the things that Shakespeare said in Henry VI, One drop of blood from thy country's bosom should grieve thee more than streams of foreign gore. Provincialism is the enemy. That might be fine and dandy in a time when the Anglo-Saxons were a distinct race defending their shores. But that is no longer a sentiment that can be tolerated in a world in which we are all living side by side. Because little Kabul is right down the road in Fremont. And maybe some of their relatives were in that wedding feast. There's 10,000 doctors in this country from Pakistan and the Arab countries. The person treating your wife or treating your child, the one you put their life into it, and when an American comedian can say on a national television program, there certainly are a lot of Muslims in this country. I went to my doctor the other day and he said, face Mecca and cough. And everybody laughed. When that joke is understood by a large number of Americans, you know that Muslim physicians are having an impact on this country. War is a negative concept. The Quran talks about war finally putting down its wrongs or its weights. The awzar of war, the weights of war. Jihad, on the other hand, is not like that. Because jihad is about fighting for what is right. And a Muslim is not allowed to fight against his conscience. He cannot fight for what he does not believe in. It is prohibited. He cannot take a life unjustly in this world. Collateral damage is an unacceptable concept as a principle. One of the English poets, Byron, said he hated men too much to feel remorse and thought the vice of wrath a sacred call to pay injuries of some on all. Thinking that revenge is this wrath, this anger that one has, that we have to fulfill our bloodlust. And this is unacceptable in our current situation. And that is why we are indeed between war and understanding. But I would contend that the vast majority of people on this planet do not want war. The vast majority of people on this planet like those people that we saw in those films, because that's been my experience of the Muslim world. People have told me, you're an American, don't you ever feel afraid in the Muslim world? And I feel afraid in downtown San Francisco. But I've never felt afraid in Cairo. I've never felt afraid in Rabat or in Casablanca or in Fez, in Mecca. I've walked in 3 a.m. in many cities in the Muslim countries and I've never felt any fear. And if I saw somebody walking down the street, the thing that he says to me is, Salaam alaikum, peace be upon you, not your money or your life. And I know what to say back. Wa alaykum as-salam. No problem between us. I was asked on the Jazeera, which is an Arab film, do you think America's at war with Islam? And I answered the question, but afterwards I regretted my answer because I realized there was a problem. And it's a logical fallacy. It's called the fallacy of personification. When we say, is America at war with Islam, well, you have to first explain to me, what do you mean by America? Do you mean Imam Shirad Wahab? Do you mean Hamza Yusuf? Do you mean Abdul Alim Sander? Do you mean Mazen Halabi? Who do you mean? Define what you mean by this nebulous thing you're calling America, because America is a tapestry of human beings. Narrow-minded, provincial, redneck, racist. They're all there, but there's also all those other people that are opposed to those narrow-minded racist people and are trying to enlighten people and educate them and expand their scope and understanding so we don't have to live in a world where we fear for our children because of the color of their skin or the fact that they're wearing a kufi on their head or our daughter. So this is something we have to ask ourselves, which America are you talking about? Because the America that I love and I respect is the America of Emerson and Henry David Thoreau and Melville and Nathaniel Hawthorne and Sojourner Truth. Ain't I a woman? Sojourner Truth. That's an America that it's those people that in spite of the wrongs of this country have always stood up and been voices of truth. And that is something that we have to get at. Because those voices can't just be in America. They have to be in Saudi Arabia. They have to be in Palestine. They have to be in France, in Italy. And those voices need to be heard. And those are the voices of sanity. Those are the voices of sanity. It's the voices that are reminding people of what is right. And they're often unpopular voices when wrong is popular. But those voices are the voices that are honored. They're not the people, the naysayers at the time. Those people, it's not the Athenians that are honored in our universities, it's the man they kill that's honored in Western universities. That's who's honored. Because he spoke the truth and made the ultimate sacrifice. And when they asked him, because the Athenians were very civilized in their barbarity, they said, what should we, we'll give you the choice of determining your punishment for crimes against the state. And Socrates replied, you should give me free meals for the rest of my life. And he said, I'm not being funny. I'm doing you a great service by reminding you what you're doing wrong. I'm fulfilling a public service. And that is why that voice is a voice that's honored after it's dead. Because it's only with the 2020 vision of hindsight that those people that were seeing down the road are suddenly seen as visionaries. He was certainly ahead of his time. Well, it's about time we caught up with all those people. Because so many of them have already died in the past to let us know where we should be. And that is why every country has ideals, because you don't measure your success with your standards. You measure the shortcomings. You measure your inability to achieve those standards. And that's why when this country was formed, they wrote in their declaration, those founding fathers, that all men are created equal. And that ideal was true, but the reality was not true, and it's still not true in this country. But the recognition of the ideal, because hypocrisy, as the French moralist said, is the homage that vice pays to virtue. The ideal has to be always there. That is what we are talking about. And in the ideals, we share too much in common as Benny Adams. In this late stage, in this 11th hour, to be fighting and tearing each other apart with, no longer with knives and even guns, but with weapons that destroy entire cities and devastate nations. The Gulf states now have untold rates of cancer, of genital deformities, all from the Gulf War. And yet this country is preparing for another, because it's become like a Hollywood movie. They brought you Gulf War I, and now that's what Hollywood does. When they have a successful movie, they make a second one. When is that camel going to get its back broken? You see, because these men are gamblers. That's what they are. That's what warmongers are. They're gamblers. Because they're thinking, well, we got away with it in the past, we can get away with it again. But there's going to be a time when you lose. When Jerry Falwell gets on national television and calls a man that one-fifth of the world considers to be the greatest human being. Why doesn't he think of the repercussions that that has, even on Christians who have traditionally lived peacefully in those countries? Because Christians have been protected in the Muslim lands for centuries. The Coptic Christians, 8 million Christians in Egypt. The Christians in India, the Christians in Pakistan, the Christians in Turkey. Because human beings are easy to get emotionally roused up in, and they're ignorant. And so you say something like that, and you don't think of the repercussions that that has. And the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, he said, don't curse your father. And the Sahaba, they said, how could we curse our father? Because that was something that the Arabs had no knowledge of, which is what we call filial impiety, a word that she no longer even used in English because the concept of honoring parents has been so far removed from our society. But in Arabic, it's one of the 7 major reasons that people destroy their souls. Rukuk al-walidain, filial impiety. The Prophet Muhammad said, don't curse your parents. They said, Ya Rasulullah, how could we curse our parents? He said, by cursing the parents of another man. And then he, in turn, curses your parents. That is the preemptive strike. That is the preemptive strike. You want to know what a preemptive strike is? It's holding people up and giving them their honor and their dignity, not humiliating them, not putting them into corners. If Saddam Hussein indeed has weapons of mass destruction, well, it seems very odd to threaten him with eliminating him because he would want to go out, it would seem, with a bang. But if it's a bunch of Iraqis that are going to get poisoned by those, maybe it's not that important because people haven't read the history of bombing. And some of the things about the history of bombing are very interesting, like who were the first people bombed? The Libyans. They were bombed by the Italians in 1911 as an experiment. They were civilians, but the Italians wanted to see how effective it was to drop bombs on people, so they went out and dropped bombs on some Bedouins. And the report came back in glowing colors. This is a very effective means of destroying people. And then Shepshelin, nobody knows about Shepshelin, and everybody knows about Guernica, because Picasso painted a tragic picture of the people of Guernica who were suffering the bomb. But nobody sees the people of Shepshelin, women and children in 1925 that were bombed by American mercenary pirates, paid by the French government, an entire city that was razed to the ground. Nobody remembers the Berbers of Shepshelin, or the bombardment of Alexandria by the British fleet. All civilians. The first, according to Sven Lindqvist, who wrote this book on the history of bombing, it's the first actual aerial bombing that was done purposefully against the civilian population. And so the belligerence that Muslims are accused of is always strikes a strange chord in the hearts of Muslims. Because if we look at history, it seems I was on a panel in Salt Lake City, and there was a Hindu and a Christian and a Jewish man, and the subject was Islam and violence. I said, I feel very odd having to defend our position when I've got Christians killing my Muslim brothers in Bosnia, I have Israelis killing my Muslim brothers in Palestine, and I've got Hindus killing my Muslim brothers in India. But Tacitus, who was a very intelligent Roman historian, said, it's human nature to hate those you hurt. You have to demonize other people when you do them wrong. That's human nature. But it's also human nature to forgive. It's also human nature to resolve conflicts. Humans are very adept at that if they choose. But it is a choice, and it's a conscious choice, and it takes courage, and it takes effort. The founding father of this country, George Washington, felt that it was in the interest of the United States to pay jizya instead of going to war with the Ottomans. And so his government agreed to pay jizya to the Ottomans. And he wrote that war is too costly an endeavor. And John Adams said that what he feared most for this country is militarism. That if the economy becomes a military economy, that it would mean the destruction and end of this country, because it's what the historian Arnold Toynbee, who studied 21 civilizations, and came to the conclusion that all of them followed identical patterns, and their destruction was always the result of the same circumstances that they themselves created, what the Greeks call nemesis. He said the pattern was Kuros, Ubris, and then the final one was the nemesis, or the calamity. The Kuros, he said, was success. A civilization becomes very successful. And then it leads to Ubris, which the Greeks sometimes called arrogance, but it really meant extravagant behavior as a result of a feeling of superiority. That we can do what we want. Might makes right. Like the Melians when Thucydides, the Greek historian in the Peloponnesian War, looked at the Athenian delegation that was sent to the island of Milos in order to invite them to join the coalition. And the Greek ambassadors, their invitation went like this. After the Melians explained to them that they preferred, like Switzerland, they didn't use that as an example, but they preferred, like Switzerland, to remain neutral in the conflict between Athens and Sparta. The Athenian ambassador said, "We are strong, and therefore we do what we will. And you are weak, and therefore you do what you must." That was the invitation to the coalition. And the Melians, according to Thucydides, said a very interesting thing. They said, basically in American colloquial language, what goes around comes around. And that if you take this type of attitude, it might be very long that you find yourselves in a very similar position to us. And by the end of the book, those Athenians are being massacred by the Spartans, and the Melians are being restored to their island by the Spartans. And that was a lesson from that historian who Colin Powell said was one of his inspirations. So I'm hoping that he read that part. George Washington preferred to pay jizya than to go to war with the Ottomans because he felt $250,000 a year was a lot cheaper than creating a military and suffering the cost of more lost lives. Because what is a life worth? According to insurance companies in this country, it's $150,000. Well, if that's the case, then in that time, it's probably about 1.8 people. So what is a life worth? A life is priceless, obviously. You can't replace your life. And I had a dear friend, an Iranian, whose brother was killed in the Battle of Sal, fighting the Iraqis, and he wrote a poem that was called The Flowers of April, because he was killed in April. And he said in that poem, and I'm just paraphrasing, he wrote it in very beautiful language, but he said, "I see the flowers of April blooming again this year, but I don't see you blooming. Those flowers come back, but you, my lost brother, will never come back." And that's something for us to think about. Code treaty, which every taxi driver in Egypt can give you an extended lecture on, and you'll be hard-pressed to find a PhD in America that's ever heard of it. The Sykes-Picot Treaty was a treaty that split up the Muslim world into spheres of influence by the British and the French. There's a film out now, and I just saw a trailer for it with Antonio Banderas, and it said on the film, "Your worst enemies are your friends you double-crossed." And I realized that Hollywood can sum up America's problems in one line, and you have to give them credit. So it's time we stop double-crossing people. It's time we lived up to these ideals. The farewell address of George Washington, in which he said, "Let our policies be with all nations that of benevolence, goodwill, and commerce." Religion dictates this. And so does good state policy. But that's what this country should be doing. We're not honest brokers in the Middle East. I could solve the problems. And people put down that I was an advisor to Bush. He didn't take my advice. And I gave a letter. In that letter, I clearly stated the reasons why Afghanistan must not be bombed. You can't bomb a country that one bomb that's dropped on that country costs more than the entire infrastructure of the city that you're bombing. You can't bomb a daisy cluster bomb on a people that have had 20 years of bombardment, that had 80 million landmines put there by Russians. And this country, we have a former national security advisor who boasts about having seduced the Russians into Afghanistan in an operation that was called Operation Mosquito to give the Russian bear malaria and watch it drop. And so 1.5 million Afghanis, those noble freedom fighters back in the Reagan years, same characters that suddenly became the evil empire at the same time that the evil empire was being transformed into our best friends. And suddenly I feel a little queasy, like I'm in an Orwellian world, or maybe it's Alice in Wonderland and I slip through the looking glass, and when I'm asked who I am, I say, I don't know, I've changed so many times today. But this is the reality of the situation. Your worst enemies are the best friends you double cross. In Surah Al-Hajj, it says, لِكُلِّ أُمَّةٍ جَعَلْنَا مَنْسَكَ. To every people we have appointed rites and ceremonies. هُمْ نَاسِكُوهُ. Which they must follow. فَلَا يُنَازِعُنَّكَ فِي الْأَمْرِ. Let them then not dispute with thee about the matter that you are in. To the Prophet Muhammad. وَجْعُوا إِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ. إِنَّكَ لَعَلَىٰ هُدًى مُسْتَقِيمٍ. And call to your Lord because you are on a straight path. وَإِنْ جَادَلُوكَ فَقُلِ اللَّهُ أَعْلَمُ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ. And if they should argue with you about what you're calling to them, say, God knows best about what you're doing. اللَّهُ يَحْكُمُ بَيْنَكُمْ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ فِيمَا كُنْتُمْ فِيهِ تَخْتَرِفُونَ. God will judge between you about your differences on the day of judgment. And so let us follow our truth, what we see to be true. And I believe that Islam is true. And I believe that it abrogates. And I believe that it is a final message to humanity. But I recognize the right of my Christian brethren and Jewish brethren and Buddhists and all of these other people to follow what their conscience tells them is true. And that is what our religion teaches us. We can invite, and that is what da'wah is. But like the great American calligrapher said, in order for an invitation to be real, it has to be open to rejection. If an invitation is really an invitation, then you have to accept the fact that some people don't want to come. And that's why Hafiz in this poem says, what would you say if you were invited to a banquet as a guest of God? And when you arrived, you found all these people at that banquet, and they had all been invited too. Hafiz knows that the Jews, the Christians, the Buddhists, they're all guests of God here. We're all on this thing together. We've all been invited here together. And the Quran says, had God wanted, He would have made you one ummah. فَاسْتَبِقُوا الْخَيْرَاتِ. So vie with one another in virtue. That is the challenge. The challenge is to oppose war, because war is a capitulation to the worst aspects of humanity. War occurs when people stop talking. But war also begins when people say the wrong thing. And the Arabs say, أول الحرب كلام. The first of war is words. So if you want to make peace with a people that are one-fifth of the world's planet, it would behoove you not to slander their prophets. It would behoove you not to say that they're mad people, to say that they're all terrorists. You would do well by lying in the shade of a tree and looking at those faces and ask yourself, is this the face of an evil person? Because I sat at the feet of mountains, and I would just look at them in awe. And they were mountains because they had internalized the way of Muhammad. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.